And to help us understand more about what these election results could mean, I'm joined by three political experts. Veteran Democratic strategist James Carville worked on many Democratic campaigns, including as lead strategist for President Bill Clinton in 1992. He's now the co-host of the podcast Politics War Room. And full disclosure, the other co-host is my husband, journalist Al Hunt. Former Republican Congresswoman Barbara Comstock. She represented Northern Virginia until 2019. She's now a senior advisor at the law firm Baker Donelson. And Amy Walter of the Cook Political Report with Amy Walter. Hello to all three of you. And Amy Walter, I'm going to start with you because you've been looking very closely at these exit polls, interviews with voters as they left their polling places yesterday. We want to try to understand more about who voted and how they voted. Tell us what you're seeing.
Well, Judy, it's pretty clear, whether it's Virginia or New Jersey, that this was really a repudiation in many ways of the president. President Biden's low approval ratings nationally are also pretty low in these blue states. The exit poll in Virginia showed that President Biden's job approval rating was just 45%. This is a state he won with 54%. So the drag that the president's disapproval rating has goes all the way, even into these state and local races, down ballot, as well as the gubernatorial. All politics now is national. It's not local anymore. So I think that is one big factor. The other is, there was a question throughout the Trump years from Democrats and Republicans about just how sturdy this suburban movement away from Republicans and to Democrats would be. As one Democrat said to me, during that era, he said, I'm worried that we're just renting these voters. And based on the results of last night, indeed, it looks like they were just rented, at least at this point. Democrats lost the ground they had made up during the Trump era with many suburban voters, especially the exurbs outside of the Beltway in Washington, in and around Richmond and in the Tidewater area. They didn't lose as much ground as going way, way back. They did about as well as, say, Barack Obama did. But you combine that with really solid turnout. I mean, above presidential level numbers for Glenn Youngkin in some of the rural areas. And that was just a politically a deadly combination for Terry McAuliffe.
And very quickly, we can show our viewers a graphic that shows that Glenn Youngkin was able to pull in, 53% of suburban voters in Virginia compared to former President Trump, 45% just last November. James Carville, to you, looking at these results, your party, what went wrong?
What went wrong was just stupid wokeness. All right, don't just look at Virginia and New Jersey. Look at Long Island. Look at Buffalo. Look at Minneapolis. Even look at Seattle, Washington. I mean, just defund the police lunacy to take Abraham Lincoln's name off of schools. I mean, that people see that, and it's just really have a suppressive effect all across the country. The Democrats, some of these people need to go to a woke detox center or something. I mean, that they're expressing the language that people just don't use. And there's a backlash and a frustration at that. And I'd be right, suburbanites in Northern Virginia, suburbanites in Northern New Jersey, you know, pulled away a little bit. Youngkin never ran any ads against Biden. And I think what he did is just let the Democrats pull the pin and watch the grenade go off and own them. And we got to change this and not be about changing dictionaries and change laws. And these faculty lounge people that sit around mulling about, I don't know what, they're not working. Look what happened in Buffalo. Seattle. I think the Republicans may win a city attorney's race in Seattle, the autonomous zones. Who could even think of something that stupid? And they're suppressing our vote. And I got news for you. You're hurting the party. You're hurting the very people that you want, that you want to help. And Terry got caught up. He's a good friend of mine. He's a good guy. You know, he got caught up in something national, and we got to change this internally, in my view.
And Barbara Comstock, we've heard that perspective from James Carville, the Democrat. What about from the Republican perspective? What did Glenn Youngkin do right? What did the Democrats do wrong?
Well, I would agree with James on the wrong end. But for Glenn, he's just a very uniquely talented candidate, competent person. And he understands that politics is about addition, not subtraction, like Donald Trump. And it's bringing people together, the sunny optimism you saw in him. And, you know, as James knows, it's the economy, stupid. And the economy was the number one issue in Virginia. And he focused on that. And as a competent businessman, but also somebody who was very involved in charity and philanthropy, he really, you know, his genuineness came through. And then focusing on the education issues, those are always state issues. And, you know, parents have been home schooling their kids online, and they want to be engaged and involved. And that, I think Michael Steele has called Terry's line on, you know, parents not being involved, sort of throwing parents under the school bus, a pretty disastrous line. And, you know, those things happen in elections. He just doubled down and wouldn't leave it. And then the public safety issue, I think James is exactly right. That public safety issue played in Virginia, and you had police and law enforcement strongly supporting Glenn. He had endorsements from a lot of Democrats in the law enforcement community because of what the Democrats have been doing. They endorsed Glenn. And I think what you saw in Minneapolis and New York with having now a new mayor who is a former police officer, I think the defund the police was also disastrous. So these things all came together in a perfect storm. But Glenn also did even better with rural base voters than Donald Trump did, because many of that was women. Because I think women realized we like to have a nice person with a sunny personality. So it wasn't that we disliked Republican ideas. We didn't like Donald Trump. People like me, an anti-Trump Republican, and my family, a lot of my friends, it was very easy to vote for the positive, bringing together, you know, vision of Glenn Youngkin after going through the toxic years of Donald Trump.
And that's what I want to ask you about, Amy Walter. I mean, Terry McAuliffe went into this campaign trying to make former President Trump a big issue, tried to tie Glenn Youngkin to him. What happened to that strategy?
Well, quite frankly, it didn't work for the reasons that Barbara just laid out. It was hard to make Glenn Youngkin a Trump clone because he didn't embrace Donald Trump. Yes, he had to sort of thread the needle during the nomination process. So he didn't completely give him a stiff arm and say, get away from me. But he did keep him out of that race. This is going to be the real question going forward, Judy, is will Republicans be able to do the same thing, be as disciplined as Youngkin was as we go into many of these Senate and House contests in 2022? The first thing that happened, there wasn't a traditional primary in Virginia this year. That meant there wasn't a long drawn out process where the president, former President Trump, could come in and sort of make mischief. That's not likely to happen in 2022. Plus, many Republicans do believe that Donald Trump is the answer in their states, which may actually work in some states. It doesn't work in a state like Virginia. So the Trump piece, while it was critical when Trump was in the White House, using right. Trump as a lightning rod doesn't work when he's not there.
And James Carville, we heard some of your prescription for what Democrats need to do or not do going forward as we look to the 2022 midterms. But what about what President Biden is saying today, that if you will just pass Build Back Better, if you'll just pass this infrastructure bill, people will be helped and that will make a difference? How much difference will that make?
Well, I think it can make an enormous difference. And by the way, it seems to me and a lot of other people that the virus numbers are really getting better. There's a ton of pent-up demand in this economy. I'm just not one of these people that thinks that we're necessarily doomed in 2022. We could have a roaring economy. This Build Back Better is going to give people a lot of confidence. And as long as we talk about things that are relevant to people and understand what they're going through in their lives and get rid of this left-wing nonsense, this claptrap I hear, I think we can be fine. But we got to stop. We got to get off of this. These people have got to understand they're not popular around the country. People don't like them. And they're voting because that's the only way that they can express themselves and how much they disagree with this. And again, I go back and it's not just Virginia and New Jersey. It's literally everywhere up to and including Seattle. And there's a real lesson here and it can be corrected, but they got these people have to understand no one, you're not popular. People don't ride in a car with you. They don't ride next to you in the subway. You're annoying people and they got to understand that.
And
very important.
And just to clarify, James Carville, before I go to Barbara Comstock, you're saying President Biden is not a drag for Democrats.
Well, look, he probably would somewhat, but I don't think so. Youngkin never mentioned President Biden. He just let the Democrats sit there and light themselves up. And literally, Terry just got caught up in it. But I think he can be, if they get this through, they got a lot of good things and they got to sell it. If they don't, every Democrat wants to be a policymaker. No one wants to be a salesperson. Well, you got to get out there and sell your product and tell people what's in it and quit worrying about being in the policy shop or being some self-important bureaucrat. That's what I think.
And Barbara Comstock, finally to you, on what if President Biden is able to get all this passed, is that going to help? Is that going to help Democrats?
Well, I think their policies are what's unpopular right now. And, you know, Biden's numbers as well as Terry's numbers were underwater, whereas, and I would point out, Trump's numbers were underwater in Virginia also. It was only Glenn Youngkin who was focusing on policies, the economy, schools, and public safety. His numbers were, you know, he had good numbers. He was positive. And so this is the kind of thing that if Republicans get back to the issues and the popular issues we can focus on, have pleasant people doing it, and get rid of the surly, you know, sore loser who hopefully is in the rear mirror now, they can do much better. And I think they will. And you know, the problem for the Democrats is they're going to continue this infighting. I mean, we had it with our Freedom Caucus and that hurt, but now everyone's united to, you know, get back in the game. So it's different for Republicans. And if, you know, Democrats have already spent a year of this infighting, and I think it had an impact. And, you know, thank you very much, Congresswoman Jayapal.
It's the day after and a lot to chew over. Barbara Comstock, James Carville, Amy Walter. Thank you all three. We appreciate it.
Say hi to Mary, James.
I will, Barbara. Always good to see you, Amy.